Now that you've found UBN Radio and discovered our quality talk shows, it's time to spread the word to friends, family, and the universe. 24 hours of music and talk. Radio without limits. That's why people keep coming back for more. That's UBNRadio.com.
The Marla and Dave Radio Experience begins in 3, 2, 1.
Now, if you're ready, we will begin.
Welcome to the Marla and Dave Radio Show. This is reality radio with a couple that keeps it real. Current events, pop culture, music, relationships, fitness, the hot topics of the day. Marla and Dave Thomas. This is the Marla and Dave Radio Show. Real
radio. Welcome!
Welcome to the Marla and Dave Show.
I did it first.
Yeah, you got me today. I ain't mad at you. I'm all discombobulated.
Here's a question. Why are the two of us... Oh, see? I was just going to say, sitting
here
like...
I'm not as ghetto as you.
Cows chewing gum.
No,
we know better
than
that.
You got me on the ghetto status.
You know, that's just not even right. Well, anyway, we had a lot of fun last week, and this week, more fun. Always a good time in the madhouse. But again, I'm Marla, for those of you who get confused. Well, Dave likes to dress up like me, so...
Or she's Dave with breasts, however you want to look at it.
And either way, you'd be happy. So it doesn't matter. It's
yeah,
all good.
I'd take him any way I can get him.
It's all good.
Don't get no ideas, Jarvis. Anyway.
Welcome to the Madhouse. Welcome to the Marla and Dave Show. Welcome to our mad world. I don't care how you want to cut it up. It's still the same thing at the end of the day.
I also want to apologize right off the bat. My computer is just on the fritz. I'm not going to be able to interact with the people in the chat room.
Somebody took a bite out of your
apple. My apple is messed up. I was at the Apple store today. They just put me on hold and wait. I had to go.
Too much.
I couldn't do it. And Marla was rude. For the record, Marla was rude. She wouldn't wait at the Apple store for me.
Okay.
I had to go to the studio. I was like, she was eating downstairs. I said, could you just, you know, bring my computer up?
So for those of you who can see my face, does it at all, in any way, look apologetic?
That's why I said you're rude.
Okay.
That's called rude.
Can we just get it? We like to launch, and there will be a new Mad Dilemma posted today, but I'm just going to launch this right off the bat, even before my mood song. Dude, what the hell is wrong with you? You really think that I can go into an Apple store? First of all, you're a musician. Everything you value. Right now, Take Six is in the middle of recording a brand new album, and I bet you most of it is on that. And when, picture me going into Apple and trying to explain what's wrong with your computer. How far do you think that would go?
You just do as you're told, like a good wife is supposed to do.
Oh.
Hello, Jarvis.
You watch too many Ice and Coco shows. You think that I'm Coco. I see that's your problem.
Hey, you know, I got to try.
Well, I'm going to play my mood song, so go ahead, Jarvis, and hit me with the
better
mood song.
Like this, that, and this, and it's like that, and like this, and like that, and it's like this.
Okay.
Then who gives a fuck about those?
So just chill.
Yay! Yeah, it's like uncensored? That. What?
Wow. So I guess you don't do as you're told. Is that what you're trying to say?
I got inspired. I went to see Straight Outta Compton, and it was just deep because it takes you back to a time
you
that
you know,
remember.
When they make a movie that's straight out of Miracle Mile or something like that, straight out of Westwood, then maybe that's your movie. But you definitely not straight out of Compton, bro.
I remember when those songs hit. I knew exactly where I was. Are you kidding?
Anyway, Jarvis hit
1989 was my jam.
But I started looking for a warning sign.
Yep. Time to go. It's like that, Jarvis.
You.
When the truth is.
When your wife starts playing Straight out of Compton, you got to look for a warning sign. That might be the sign that you need. It's time to make a change.
Oh, wow. Well, anyway, we like to start off with our week in review. And so right off the bat, we had a mad first. For those of you who joined us on August the 3rd, we had one of our serious topics, but we talked about women who are in a 40-something crisis. Mm. And our guest, Nina Gosh-Garin, came on. And since that, she called us and asked us post her situation, I guess, with her ex to remove the show at his request. And
no comment.
I'm commenting.
I have no comment.
I'm commenting because number one, we did it out of respect, and we did it because that's our own personal integrity. But I know how hard that is. And there have been women, by the way, who've been hitting me up left and right asking to have the link. We do have the link. But out of respect for her, we removed it from the Marla and Dave website and we removed it from YouTube only.
And we will, if you really need the show and if that's something that you might be going through in your life, that 40-something
crisis, which was deep. And it
issue.
Was, yeah.
If, as a female, you know, hit us up. We'll make sure you get a good look.
The tennis update is, I don't care what Dave says,
nah.
I'm back on top. Dude,
nah.
I won last week. Two, you won one. We only played three times.
We played five times last
week. How can you
week?
Have no memory in that all that head? I don't get it. Is there like an extra rim of...
How do you think that you have any memory in that little shrunken dome you got over there?
Okay.
Look like you've been to the witch doctor.
Okay.
One too many times.
Okay, Beetlejuice. You want to go there?
I didn't say it.
Okay, so we'll leave that. We'll leave it to the scorekeeper. Sandra Hawkins
Sandra
has got
Hawkins
to be in here.
Sandra Hawkins is in the chat room, I know, even though I'm not watching.
Sandra Hawkins, I know that you know exactly, because, by the way, we've got David Arnold in the studio with us. And, David, we have someone officially. Can we? His mic is
his mic. He's been checking on that mic for about 5 minutes. Like,
yeah, because I wanted to chime in a long time ago.
Okay, jump in, buddy.
First of all, I got to sit between these two married asses, listen to them bicker back and forth. I don't know how y'all work with each other. I left my wife to come here.
You know,
most people get a job to not be with their spouses. Y'all two
work that's
together.
Why I play golf,
what
though.
What the hell? Well.
So anyway, so on top of that, and we had our son turned 26 on the 14th of August, and that day ended with him not telling us, crashing.
He went to bed, woke up the next day. Marla comes running into the ruined house. Oh my God!
So he had a wreck. Did he hit a
person? Car's all wrecked up outside.
He didn't say a word. He came home at 5 o'clock in the morning. Dude, what happened? He went out on a date. I had a bad day.
He hit the chick he took out on the date.
I didn't see no blood. So
they went to see Straight Outta Compton, and he ran this bitch over.
Wait a minute.
See, like mother, like son.
Were you there? Because that's exactly where he was.
That's what happened when you go to see Straight Outta Compton. I've seen it.
You end up killing somebody by mistake. Didn't even mean to.
Took my wife. This bitch slapped the shit out of me for no reason. I'm like, oh, you got an attitude.
That's because you're too light-skinned. She didn't know what to do with you.
Well, I'm going to make another admission. My clock's not working, so I don't know what happened, Jarvis. You know.
It's all right.
I apologize.
Dave,
Marla,
you
got to hold it down.
I got you. I got you, bro.
Do you
want the big old clock? Because you know you can't see. And,
you know,
which
I can't
I'm
going to
get into that
there.
With David Arnold.
Yeah. Oh, thank you, David. Can you pass that to me?
No, I can see behind him.
Oh, good. I need this. Perfect.
There you go.
Thank you.
We'll get into that. And
see,
David,
that's how you mediate, see?
And David Arnold.
You just brought some love back into the studio.
I've been married long enough to know. But y'all got about two more shows left.
That is hilarious. So that was, we've been managing the birthday crash is what I'll call it. And then to go forward without too much... I made the announcement this past week that I am going to be appearing and joining the Love and Hip Hop Hollywood 2 cast with my daughter Monice. And so, church pray. And I will let you know before you guys, you're already starting in on me. I see it when you see it. So if
don't
you
be asking
to
for the spoilers.
About an episode, we will discuss it episode at a time. Now, even though shooting is happening, I don't know exactly what you're going to see because I haven't seen it. So,
but
when
if
we
you
see
hit me
it,
up, I'm going to give you the lowdown every time.
But I can't.
I'm just going to bust them out.
I can guarantee you that you're not going to see any Monice mama snatching grabs. That's not going to happen.
Oh, you're not going to slap and snatch?
Well, she's not going to slap and snatch me. That's the bottom line.
Okay.
That's
okay.
Not going down. I'm straight out of.
Straight out of Oakwood.
No, he didn't. As you heard, we got comedian David Arnold in the studio with us today. He's going to join the Madhouse, and it's going to be fun and funny. Relax, sit back, kick your feet up. www.marlandave.com is our home website. 323-284-7826. I have
a tooth.
Yeah.
It's my tooth.
Is that what it is? 323-284-7826 is the number to call. Hit us up.
You're listening to the Marla and Dave Radio Show on the Universal Broadcast Network. Current events, pop culture, the hot topics of the day. It's time for MaD News on the Marla and Dave Radio Show. Ladies and gentlemen, Marla and Dave.
All right, this is a segment where we cover three news topics, David. And the news topics are either Are You Kidding Me, which is our first topic.
Mm-hmm.
Are You Kidding Me today is so unbelievable that I have to laugh my ass all the way off.
It sounds like a jackass. This might be the jackass guys just doing something like this. I don't know.
But there was a man who was dressed in a realistic grizzly bear outfit, the head and all, and he was harassing a mother bear.
He's teasing the mother bear
and
the cubs.
And her two cubs in Alaska when the fishing and game people came up and caught him. He was like 10 feet away from the mother bear.
He's running up on the cubs.
Even David looks confused. Like, so we don't know why he did it.
Because he's white. Because black people don't do that. Black people got other.
You don't even have to take the suit off. We know
who's
in there.
White. We're like, get down, Bob. Get on your knees. We know it's you.
Come on, Darren.
We don't go to Alaska. I get it.
Right. That's another thing. Ain't no black people in Alaska. So you know. Who does that?
That's an Are You Kidding Me for you. And now,
all right, so he said, she said. Matt Barnes, I mean, he tried to actually come up in the game, I guess. He's working on his social
game?
Network skills.
The dating game?
He says he's dating Rihanna, and Rihanna's like, we ain't dating. I don't even know you. I don't even know who you are. Matt who?
And I'm going out with Janet Jackson after this.
I'm coming with him. I'm coming with David.
But what was interesting about this story is when Matt Barnes, the statement I believe that was made, they were friends. And
right.
Then someone asked him, what's up? You guys are going to be separated by distance. And he made the statement, it's not that big of a deal.
She's rich. Yeah, but the
in other words, he can fly me back and forth. She can fly
me in.
That's what that
meant. Yeah, I guess that's what he meant.
Is that what?
That's what that means. She's rich. That means we're going to make it. Money bridges the gap to all distance.
Well, this gap is really big because she was like, I don't know you.
Well, that's a different
gap. Excuse me, sir.
He's in the wrong wallet. I don't know where you got that from. All right, so we are going to agree to disagree on this next one, straight out of Compton.
Wait.
The movie that Marla loves so much.
Incredible
David
movie.
Comes. See?
I haven't had the chance to see it yet.
Oh,
I was
you
working.
Can't come on out.
Yeah, no, I can't get down like that.
Let me tell you this, though. I will say this, because you grew up in a nice neighborhood like I did. And I thought it was going to be ridiculous. I didn't know what to expect, and I saw the movie, and it was incredible.
Phenomenal.
Now, people are going
nine.
Crazy about the
it
movie.
Was in, I saw it at a press. My wife covered the movie, and it was an incredible movie.
Well, here's
it's one of the best movies I've seen in years.
Here's the thing. So now, the movie comes out, and the cops are on tactical alert for the opening weekend.
Oh, yeah.
At the releases around the theaters around the country.
In the hood.
In the hood.
Right.
Yeah, like we're going to shoot up ourselves.
Okay,
we
are. But hold on.
You think so?
It's going to draw.
You know what's going to happen? They're going to shoot us.
Yes, they're going to shoot. If you go, I mean, you need to go to the movies out where you live, okay?
Yeah, you know what I'm saying?
Not
you can't
where,
go,
you
to
don't go to
where
the hood.
Cops are.
Right, yeah. But there's people who that's where they live, so that's where they're going
to
go.
But they shoot us anyway when we go to the hood.
I got a couple of bullet holes in my butt right now.
I'm about to say, when you go to the hood, you got to bring your gun. But
you are a gospel singer. You do not have bullet holes.
Yeah, no. You should be covered by the faith and the blood of the Lord anyway.
I wish I was, but these cops out here nowadays, you just never know.
The point that we're making is David was shocked at the fact and was appalled that they would have a police force. And this is where we agree to disagree. Of course you would have a police force. Because number one, it's
in
the kind of movie. It makes you kind of mad. Like the bottom, and people are.
But
like,
it's going to draw both sides, the Crips and the Bloods, too. It's going to draw
in
both
the,
of
in
them.
In the suburbs of Colorado, you know, another guy walks in and starts shooting everybody up.
Nashville?
Maybe they should start.
Yes.
Yeah, Nashville, start coming out with a hatchet.
Well,
maybe
if they
should
do
start
a movie
out
straight out of Oklahoma, then that's when that's going to happen. Then some white people are going to shoot some people up in the theater.
Straight out of Baghdad.
I almost did something that would be very uncool. It just nuked the whole building. Everybody
that
gone.
It's crazy. Well, again, on that, we will agree to disagree, Dave.
Yeah, no, I think it's ridiculous.
Wow.
You know what I mean?
And this is a mad first that I actually got a guy to side with me.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Well, it's
about,
you need, I mean, yeah. When,
in
that particular thing, if you have a gang
cluster that happens in here.
Yeah, but if you have a gang-related, you know, movie that came from that, it's going to draw two different sides, and it's in Compton. You know, it's putting Compton on the map in the spotlight.
Yeah, it is.
Yes, yeah.
You know.
Well,
but it's a dope ass movie.
If you don't ask, we can't tell. Remember, write in at www.marlandave.com. Ask Marla and Dave. Let us know what's on your mind. Send your questions in. We'll get to them on air. 323 1-888-284-7826. We'll be right back with David Arnold.
Truth?
Then get ready for a real radio experience.
Real radio experience.
Ladies and gentlemen, Marla and Dave.
David A. Arnold.
What's up, girl?
What's happening?
How you doing?
Is she adding letters to your name? Is your middle name actual?
Yeah, that's my actual middle name.
Oh, okay.
I use David A. because there's a famous movie soundtrack composer named David Arnold.
Oh, okay.
Who does all the, you know.
You don't want him getting all your press.
I don't. And what's so funny is, he hit me on Twitter one time and said, I didn't know I was a funny black comedian.
Ah.
And he's like, I said, I didn't know I did soundtracks for all of the James Bond movies and all of the.
Oh, y'all should change checks. Some checks one day.
He's pretty big. So we've become friends on
check
social
swap.
Media. Yeah, right. So I went to David A. Arnold, so I would, you know.
See, you thought I was taking liberties?
That was very nice of you, man,
yeah. You know. Yeah, well, actually.
Very nice of you.
You know what's so funny is I actually wanted David A. Arnold from the beginning because of, when I was a kid, I was a huge fan of Michael J. Fox.
Ah.
So I thought it was cool to use
the middle initial.
So I said, let me use my middle initial. Then it happened to come in handy.
Getting all official on.
Well, here's the thing that people probably do not know.
Probably.
About you. That okay. We actually are 1 degree of separation.
Yes. You
grew up in the Adventist community.
I did. Mm-hmm.
And Cleveland.
All my life in Cleveland, Ohio.
Right. And now look at you, full of curse words. It's awesome. No. What happened?
He done left Jesus on the East Coast.
I still go to church. I just don't say fuck it when I'm in church.
I hope not.
No, I did. Yeah, all my family graduated from Oakwood College, and you know, I went to Pine Forge, and
oh wow,
I grew up.
You're super Adventist.
Yeah, I went. I was the only one in my family to be expelled from Pine Forge. So
were you?
Yes.
What'd you get kicked out for, David?
Trying to blackmail Dr. Cheatham.
You went to hardcore. You really wanted that grade.
I wanted his daughter.
Oh, yeah. You know, I have to say this too. Adventist schools, high schools, academies.
Back, she was kind of cute,
Marta.
Yeah, Marta.
I mean, Marta was dated for years.
They're the only school that I know of in high school where you can actually be expelled for actually having a girl situation. Public school.
Well, I got caught in his house at night.
Oh, well, that's
like
personal.
3 a.m.
Oh, yeah.
So that's why I got
so
put
you
out.
As you were running out the door,
out.
You were grabbing blackmail evidence on the way out the door. Oh, my God.
He put me out. So he's like, you got to get your ass out of here.
The whole school, though. Just,
it was big, like the Allegheny East Conference. It was huge news.
So what'd you do? You just went off to public school? And
yeah, I went to public school and realized I was funny.
I was about to say, I'm growing up in an Adventist environment. I'm shocked you become a comedian.
You know what? I've never was like the class clown. I was never that dude. I think I was funny without trying to be funny, is what people told me.
Right.
And then when I got to a point where I wanted to try it, it just naturally came out.
And where did that start? Where did
Cleveland, at a comedy club called Hilarities in Cleveland, Ohio.
Okay.
I went up, I did one show, I bombed horribly.
Did you write your jokes, or you just were like talking?
I wrote my
off your
jokes. I wrote some jokes, and I didn't do well. And then I didn't go back on stage for 10 years.
Was this open mic kind of situation?
Yeah, open mic, and I didn't go back on stage for 10 years until after I got out of the military. But for the whole time, I was writing like funny ideas and jokes. So I had like this shoebox.
10 years.
10 years.
That's crazy.
And then when I got back on stage again, I never got off, and that was 19 years ago.
Wow. Well,
where was that second incarnation?
In the military. I was in Bethesda, Maryland. After I got out of it, I was right about to get out the Navy.
That sounds like a tough audience.
Yes, it was something, especially when you were brand new. So you know, I was like, and I had to get out the military because I was not. I just no discipline. That kind of stuff was not for me. I knew it.
But you went your whole. I mean, did you leave? Was it?
Did I leave where? The military?
Like,
no, I got me an honorable discharge, you know. But I mean, it was over. I wasn't going to do.
Did you weren't up a career military man.
No, I wasn't getting up in the morning.
You wasn't going for colonel.
Listen, they took me to jail my first day at the military because I didn't get up to come to work. I woke up, they were standing over me with guns. That's what I said. I woke up because we were supposed to go to work, and I was like, I ain't driving to go to work. Oh, it's black people. It's black. It was a couple black people, but I was like, I ain't going to work today. I woke up, the police was standing over me like,
you
going to work.
My face is that he has a history. He's a veggie criminal. He got kicked out of, he got put in jail for not waking up in the military, not kicked out of Adventist University for being in the principal's
daughter's house.
Yeah, your petty crime is a.
That's what I do. Before I leave her, I'm going to steal one of these lights. Nothing they can get me no time. Just a good stern talking to.
Jarvis, you're going to get us in trouble. Tony's gone. Jarvis, it's on you, man. You better guard those lampshades.
We've got active people in the chat room. Yvette Foy says.
Oh, hey, Yvette.
She says, where's that shoebox? I bet it's worth thousands of dollars now.
You know what? That's so funny. I do have a lot of those jokes that I wrote. It's still, and I actually do some of those jokes. Wow. I actually did them on my first stand-up special.
Okay.
I actually did some of them.
So when did stand-up become your gig?
Your main gig.
Yeah.
10 years ago. Because in the military, I became a nurse, and I worked as a nurse for many years. And I did that even out here. I ran a family practice clinic in Culver City while I pursued stand-up. And then about 10 years ago, I landed a TV show on TV One called Black Man Revealed.
All right.
Hosted that show. And it was soon after that, I quit working, and I just started doing stand-up. And that's it. I mean, I started doing stand-up and television appearances. Then I started writing television, and that's been 10 years now. So that's how I make my money now.
That's how you do your thing.
That's it.
And which do you prefer? Do you prefer
stand-up?
Stand-up
in front of the camera.
Live, right? Okay.
Yeah. Stand-up in front of the camera.
Stand-up. I mean, I'm getting ready to film another. I got my own TV show. I just signed a deal for. But
nice.
I enjoy being on stage. I enjoy performing. I write because I can.
Okay.
You know what I mean? And that was the thing that like offered me when I first got my first job. I think I wrote for Tony Rock Project on UPN or My Network TV.
How hard is that? When you say you write for someone, are you writing your material and it just happens to fit?
No, it's not my material. I write for whatever
right.
I'm
so do you have to get to
for.
Know, like,
learn their
them?
Voice, so to speak, the personality?
There's certain people that you can do it for, you know, that you know their voice. Like, when I wrote for Tony Rock, it was really easy. Writing here, I mean, I worked on this lot here I write Real Husbands of Hollywood with Kevin Hart.
Yeah.
And that's really easy because Kevin and I have been friends for like 15 years.
Could you write a good joke for Boris?
I've written plenty of jokes for Boris. I actually did, you know, I just did, because I was actually going to write on their TV show.
Right, Boris and Nicole.
Boris and Nicole, which I did a few episodes a couple of weeks ago. And I was going to, but I was writing on another show, so I wasn't available. Yeah, Boris is very dry.
Yeah, he needs, you know, you got to.
Boris is not.
Help Boris out
Boris
a little
is,
bit.
Boris is German.
But you know what? That could work.
Right. He's
it
just really
work,
dry. You just got to get to know Boris.
Lost in translation. He went to that. He's German.
He's German.
Oh, we get it. Yeah.
Boris always want to be poignant. I'm like, put your shirt on and listen to what the hell I'm telling you to say. Oh, sexy ass.
That's hilarious.
Does this nipple help? Right. Oh, shout. Does this nipple help in any way? Can I free my nipple?
So you literally just pair up and you decide. Does anyone come to you and say, "Hey, I want you to write," and you're like,
"Yeah,
that's not a feel. That wouldn't work for me."
All the time.
Oh, you turn people
Stacey
down.
Stacey
like,
Dash
I'm not
called me.
Do it.
Stacey Dash called me because she wanted to be a comedian. Because you know I teach a stand-up comedy class too, which is
we didn't know that.
Okay, I started teaching a stand-up comedy class about 6 years ago. It's probably the largest stand-up comedy class in the
country.
Okay,
so let's talk about that right quick.
Yeah, this is going
to
be funny.
How do you actually, so Dave comes to you and Dave says, hey, Dave.
Oh, he just says,
I go, Dave, you're not going to make it.
You already. Dave,
I need
just
you to go back with
it.
Marla.
And y'all, Boris is out there waiting on you. Try to take your shirt off.
You Boris
don't do that well.
You Boris and Stacey Dash is in a group together.
That is hilarious. What advice?
I can't teach you to be funny.
I understand, but if
that's the first
work?
Advice.
How's
because
the class
this,
work?
This is the thing about stand-up. Stand-up is it's a mechanics thing to it.
You got to already be funny to get in the door.
Well, I mean, here's the thing. I don't tell anybody that comes to work with me. I can't tell them that you don't have what it. I'll never say that to you.
Right.
What I'll tell
even
you
though
is
he just said that to me.
Right.
But you're wearing your shirt, so that counts for something.
Yeah, my shirt was a little too obese.
I didn't realize his shirt buttoned down to his belly button. I didn't realize that.
I'm trying to,
damn,
know.
What's going on here? Why the lights getting
you
there?
You're waiting out of here. Squee!
No, you know, you don't tell people. You watch somebody and see what they have, but it's mechanics to being a stand-up. I mean, you have to. Some people possess one or the other. They can perform and they have no material and they can't write, or they can write but they can't perform. And I can't give you. You know, I can't give you a funny
Can both of those kinds of people come to the class?
Yes. I get people who are great writers but cannot perform. And I get people who can perform, but they can't write a joke to save their life.
But isn't it better to write your own material? Like, in other words, aren't
I don't
you
write your material.
No, I'm just saying, as a comedy, as a comic, a stand-up, wouldn't you encourage somebody to, isn't it better to deliver something that is funny to you because it's your own.
Yeah, that's what I mean. That's one of the things that I teach in my class, is that the funniest comedy comes from the comedy that's within in you.
Right.
That's your experience.
How
because how you see things, and because when you do that, it's grounded in you.
Right.
So if we all started talking about religion right now,
yeah.
Eventually, we would all split.
We can all talk about Dr. Cheatham.
Yes, exactly. You know what I mean?
Because you know where to go with that.
We know where to go with that.
I didn't go to Pine Forest.
But you know what Dr. Cheatham is. But
I
you,
don't.
But okay, well, listen. But you have a take on religion.
I do.
And we are going to separate at some point. And when you're talking about what you believe in,
right.
You don't care any longer what everybody else thinks.
Yeah.
And that's where real comedy comes from. So when I'm performing,
so you can't ad lib what you don't know. Is what you're saying,
right? I can't write a bunch of jokes about being an engineer. I can write surfacey stuff,
right?
But I can't write
real
comedy.
Because you can't get into the depth of that. Because you can't.
That's right, and that's what I try to.
You
tell
can't personally
people.
Relate.
Now what you guys don't see is Jarvis is over here. Yeah, he doesn't know nothing about what I do.
Right.
This is real stuff. I'm technical over here.
I was just about to say, can you turn Jarvis into a comedian?
Jarvis laughed twice since we met him. I need to engineer that laughs and shit. He just smirks every once
Jarvis,
in a while.
In case you didn't know it, David, Jarvis is in charge of the actual laugh track. He has a very important
He ain't hit the button one time.
Yeah, you know, he's focusing. Jarvis is focused, though.
You don't know.
Yes.
Plus, it's interesting because this is the second week in a row. I feel like I've run into some kind of a light skin monotony with our guests.
Light skin's coming back.
I don't know. Everybody always says that, coming back. I've never been anywhere.
Well, first of all, David doesn't want to be with your group because he tried to brown up before you got in here. Real bad.
Let me tell you something, Dave. Yeah. I don't know what's been your experience.
No, light skin went away around the Eddie Murphy era.
No,
you know what I'm saying?
I didn't stop getting ass.
He's
I was getting
singer.
All. Only thing that was added to it was, I don't even like light skin dudes like you. I'm like, yeah, all right, bitch, let's just go. That's the only thing I ever heard.
You were the exception to the rule.
I heard all these excuses. I don't even normally do this. Yeah, I know. Just turn over.
That's
you don't seem light skin at all. Yeah, I know. Yeah, it's just
I know. Yeah, yeah.
Again, I will say that the light skin guys are holding down the comedy corner, because Howard came in with some hilarious stuff too, talking about
Howard
Hewitt.
Oh yeah,
last week.
Oh yeah, Howard Hewitt.
And he was talking about, you know, he's like, man, we talked about groupies, and he was like, it's the gospel groupies, man. They are
probably the worst. Because they got to keep it in. They got it. They ain't supposed
they just
to.
Let it loose.
I ain't supposed to want to pull my titties out. I just got to.
Oh, my God.
Thank you.
Oh, my God.
Wow. So when you say if you just don't have it, somebody's
Some
funny,
people don't have
and
it.
And they're good writers. What's with the stand-up? They just don't have it because they can't connect to the audience. They're nervous.
They're not
what's
good
up?
Performers. Okay. Some people are just not good performers. They're not fluid on stage. They're not, you know,
it's a timing.
It's a timing thing. It's it's like when you find somebody who has it.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I can't give you it.
Right. Yeah.
It is something you have or you don't have it.
I've been trying to figure out what it actually is.
And you can't
is it just an entertainment
value?
I'm gonna tell you what
it is. It's a phone call. We'll pick up go ahead. We have a call.
You're on the air with Marla and Dave
and
David Arnold.
Hey, David.
Hey,
can we barely hear you, Jarvis. Can you?
Hi there. So what's your name and where are you calling from?
My name is Barbara.
Hi, Barbara.
Hello.
Barbara, are you scared to say your last name?
Yes.
Okay, that's cool. That's cool. I'm with that.
We'll let you just be Barbara X. Barbara, do you have a question or a comment for our guest or for Marlon Dave?
I wasn't able to log on. Something's wrong with the tablet that David bought me, and I can't log on. I don't know.
Oh, Lord. Oh, Lord.
That's my mother.
Barbara, Jesus. You know what
Did
it
you
is?
Call? What?
Here's the problem. The problem
this is
that
Mrs. Arnold.
This wait, mother. Wait. Here's what.
Cut her off.
No,
no. We need Barbara. We're glad. We're so glad you called.
We are glad you called. Thank you so much for calling
mother,
us.
Mother, what?
What's the problem? He bought me a cheap tablet.
No, what ends up?
It's not an iPad. Is that what you're saying? No, it's not an iPad.
That's not the problem. The problem is that you have the iPad 1. He has. We're already up to level 16. He and his family, the girls and David, they've got, you know, they got the new stuff. I think that does yours look anything?
They got an Apple Watch. They got everything. You don't have that, Mom? You don't. Oh,
Barbara,
man,
can I ask you another question? Does the device you have, do you have to erase it with sand? Do you shake it?
That's funny.
Does it look anything like an Etch-a-Sketch?
But it's not quite that bad. It just says I've got to go to the browser and refresh, and I can't do all of that.
Yeah, see?
So how did you deal with David? I'm glad. We are glad. Let me just say this. I hope you can see your son, but I love it because he's all brazen and bold. Then his mother calls and he backs away from the mic.
Now, Mom, can he come to the dinner table at home and just start cursing his head off?
No, sir.
Okay. Now, what happened when he got kicked out of Pine Forest?
We want to know about your son, the ladies' man.
Okay. Well, first of all, it was embarrassing for my entire family. That's the first thing. We had to figure out a way to cover the shit up.
Okay? Oh, my. That just got real. Jarvis, please turn Barbara up a little bit.
He can't.
Wait a minute.
See where I get the cussing from?
Wait. I had to figure out a way to get him back in public school back here in Ohio.
Okay. So he brought embarrassment to the family.
Right. And it was absolutely terrible. It was embarrassing.
Yeah.
It was absolutely embarrassing because, you know, my family, we have a certain standard. We've been through Pine Forest for 30 years.
Mm-hmm.
And he's the first one that got put out. It was embarrassing.
Well, now, Mom, you know you got him sweating in the studio.
That is.
All right, Mom. Thanks for calling.
I know he is sweating his little ass off.
Well, you know what, Mom? We appreciate you calling so much. And, you know.
And wait, Barbara, before you go, if you went to Pine Forge, some kind of way, I know we have to be linked. You have to know my mother.
Who's your mom?
Marlene Cox. You know the Coxes? Well, I would tell you her age, but then the show will be over. We'll go flatline. Yeah.
She'll pull the plug on
my
the studio.
Then she's going to call and we'll have a mother duel beating up on their children.
The same thing with me, but let me say this in David's defense. I haven't been able to hear what you guys were talking about.
They're about to cut you off.
What he was saying, but he is truly, truly a gem. It has been my honor to raise him as a child and see him get to where he is today. I'm just so thankful.
Oh, thanks, Mom.
That he found his place in the world.
Well, we're thankful,
Thank
too,
you,
because
Mom.
He makes us all laugh, and we also think he's a pretty swell guy. Thanks for calling
us. Thanks for calling, Barbara.
Bye, Mom.
Wow. You know what? From the mouth of a mom, we'll be right back after the break.
I can't believe she called.
Hey, guys, listen up. Learn something. 26 years of marriage from two unique perspectives equals 52 years of relationship experience.
It's time for Ask Marla and Dave.
To your questions about life, love, and relationship based on Marla and Dave's real life experience.
It's about to get real. Ask Marla and Dave.
Okay, so this Ask Marla and Dave really is Ask Marla. It says last year Marla announced that, well, I guess it's to both of us, your daughter Monice will be appearing as a cast member on Love & Hip Hop Hollywood and followed up by letting us know that your family made a conscious decision to not participate. This weekend, Marla announced that she would be appearing in season 2. The simple question is, what changed her mind? Or what changed my mind? Well, number one, Monice is going to do what Monice is going to do. She's 28 years old. Last season was kind of unique in the way that, you know, she kind of became a breakout that America wanted to know more about
right.
who she was. So now that she's kind of found her place there, you know, it's almost a natural thing for us to come in some shape, form, or fashion, which happens to be me, to kind of just bridge that gap as to who she is, how she was raised, and where she came from, which is interesting because I was looking forward to really being truthful and sharing my perspective in a real way. because
and it was really me who was concerned with being on camera. I'm still afraid to get on camera with Moniz.
Right.
Why? Why is that?
You just never know what she's going to say and or do.
Yeah. David is very much more of a, I can handle that because to me, I'm usually so transparent anyway.
Right. I'm kind of like Barbara. You know, I'm going to be mad when Moniz gets kicked out of Pine Forest. So.
Yeah, except I know that Moniz won't, she'll be the last one on any island because she will kill. Moniz will manipulate and kill. She'll get to the end. If she's going to be on Survivor, she's going to be the last one standing.
Wow.
So what did, again, what changed your mind?
So what changed my mind is just really giving everybody an inside look at the reality of what we are as a family and where she really came from. So connecting the dots is also important to me as it is now necessary to tell her story.
Oh, so nice. I guess they're going to have to look forward to every episode to see what you are going to say and what Moniz is going to do.
I just...
Are you doing every episode?
I understand that I'm in several.
Okay. That's good.
So, yeah.
It should be fun. Yeah, my wife will... Well, see, maybe. Well, I've never watched any of it.
You know what? Your wife needs some... Being at home with you, your mom called in. I don't know. I'm sure your mom... Your wife probably...
If my wife wasn't working right now, she'd call in, probably.
Yeah, I'm sure your wife has to do, you know, a lot of reality TV just to escape. David, do you torture your wife at home?
While Marla and David are actually having this conversation on the side, 323-284-7826, that was Ask Marla and Dave. Remember, if you don't ask, we won't tell you. Hit us up. Back to the show.
Welcome back to the Marla and Dave Radio Show. Marla and Dave want to talk to you. Phone lines are open at 323-284-7826. 323-284-7826.
Tony Fontana's in the chat room, and he said your mom was funny, and he separated that out. You know,
that
everybody, everybody needs a little, everybody needs their mom every now and then to just come in and regulate. But here's what's funny, and that's a great segue because we're going to roll into talking about your family. But you got a little, you know, you were just about to perspire a little.
Because you don't know what my mother going to say and how much you've been drinking before she called in.
Oh, now that she's off the line, he's going to launch
I don't know. When I start sweating, I'm like, oh, shit, what's she going to say?
David, do you have siblings?
Yeah, I got three sisters. I'm the oldest. I got three sisters.
So all of them are younger than you.
Yeah, that makes me the oldest.
And that's
the definition
of the
oldest.
The point that I'm making is, as the older brother,
yeah,
if they pulled any of the shenanigans that you pulled, were you like the regulator? Were you a protective older brother? You just let them be their own selves?
No, I only had to get into it with one person one time about my sister. One time, my whole, you know,
which
life
sister?
That I can remember. My sister right below me, Tammy. That was only, I mean, literally only one time. I've never really had to deal with... They never attracted crazy dudes either.
So they made good decisions.
They made good choices. Yeah,
they went straight through Pine Forge.
Yes, only one of my sisters
probably
graduated
went to
from
Andrews
Oakwood.
University right after. Not even Oakwood.
Right. Only one of them
straight
went to
Pioneer
Oakwood
Memorial.
Right. But yeah, no, I was never that brother. Really, I was never. That like you talking to my sister. I was never that.
Right.
I've always been a bit of a not. I don't want to say goofball. I've just been a very
laid back,
happy go. Yeah. But
you're
then,
not
like,
looking for confrontation.
No, and then when it finds me, then there's another issue. But
come on.
Yeah, don't let the light skin fool you. don't let it, it's either nice or jail. It ain't no in between, ain't no talking. I swear I've been like that all my life.
So now you're married, you've got two daughters.
Yeah.
And are you the same laid back guy when
no.
it comes to, see?
How old are your daughters?
They're babies, they're 8 and 10.
Still, okay,
but they're 8 and 10.
They plan.
Yeah, they're 8 and 10.
And they're cute.
They're something. They are, you know, and I can see what's coming, and I'm hoping that by the time they get there,
what
I
do you
will
see,
be...
David?
Wait, does one of them have it? Either of them have it, or both?
I've watched them on Periscope, and one is pretty funny.
Yeah, Ashlyn is the little one.
Yeah,
she's,
the little one
yeah,
is...
she's out of... Ashlyn
the more precocious.
Yeah, she's, you know, Anna Grace is a little bit more in the cut like I was, but Ashlyn is, yeah, she's out there in your face.
Yeah.
And, you know, Ashlyn is a natural dancer like her mother is. You know, my wife was a New York Radio City Rockette.
Oh, I didn't know that.
Yeah, she was the third African American to dance online with the Rockettes.
Nice.
Yeah, so she's, and then she danced on Broadway for many years, and then she toured with Jimmy Buffett singing with him and dancing for him. So she's had a... And
so she's smoked a lot of weed.
No. You know what? I would love that. Maybe she would chill the fuck out.
You said Jimmy Buffett. I was like, on the road with you. Right, exactly. Oh, yeah, we get that.
You know what's so funny is that you said that because it's two vans. It's the weed smoking van.
That's
and
then it's
the van
funny.
That don't. She's always in the machine. This and is my wife. We shouldn't smoke because that's illegal.
Right. Like, I can't see.
I said, we cheated on our taxes for years. What's wrong with you?
I can't see that. Yeah.
She will not. She is the. My wife's from Indianapolis. Okay. She is the most middle
she's
of
She's just straight.
I put it this way. His wife tries to flee the scene like a roach when you turn the lights on when he's on his Periscope. And he's constantly.
Oh, like me.
Yes. Because
you never know what you're going to say.
Yeah, he's constantly Periscoping and he's constantly finding his wife and the girls. Right. And his wife is like, oh.
Yeah, she's like, David, what are you
getting? Okay. It's and so she funny. Just turns away like, oh my God.
We got offered a reality show.
Okay.
And we turned it down for a couple of reasons. But my wife was like, I don't think that we're funny. I don't think that this is
now,
funny.
Now was that a slap in the face insult for you?
I was like, oh, who you might not to? Be funny, but I'm fantastic.
That's what I do.
I'm like, I'm like, I don't know how you think we eating in this bitch because I'm funny.
You just ate that joke.
Right, exactly.
You know? You sleeping on a joke now.
Really?
That's right.
They actually did touch hands and touch and agree. That's what you're going to do?
That's funny.
That's right. But, you know, yeah, I live in a house. I went from a house full of women to a house full of women. So I know women really well.
You know, if you had a son, they would throw your whole world off balance.
Probably.
Yeah.
I don't know. And everybody goes, don't you want a son? I did in the beginning, like when you first, you know. You're like, oh, I don't want a son. And then when I had a girl... When I
Thank
had a
you,
girl,
but I'm glad you're saying this.
But when I had a girl, I was like, okay. And then when I had another girl, I started laughing.
Yeah.
Because I was like, okay, God, I see what you're doing.
You're going to get it back.
Yes, I knew it. And yeah. But it was two
the
things.
The blackmail moment came to him right there things, in the hospital at delivery.
Yes, reverse light skin.
Two things I saw happen. I was like, okay, I got a girl. I got two daughters to make me understand what I took people through back in the day.
Right.
And the second thing is, I got two daughters because I'm going to need somebody to take care of me when I'm 80. Because daughters take care of their father. Boys don't give a fuck about their daddy.
Right. And not to mention the fact, no matter how much machismo it makes you feel like, the boys at 26 most likely will run your car into a wall and won't
and
say
not
a word.
Say nothing.
Yeah. Yeah.
The daughter
yeah,
will call daughter you would, from the accident scene.
My daughter could get a scratch and say, Mom.
That's just how they are.
Lexi, this is the truth. Our 22-year-old, when she first started driving, bumped into a lady in the grocery store, back to her first driving experience,
right.
There was really virtually no damage. She burst into tears, yes. Called us from the parking lot.
Right.
But the lady was kind of, you know,
you
she was over the top.
You let that lady get away with everything because I was going to beat that lady's ass.
And that's why you're on the reality show.
Because I wasn't playing. Because I'm like, you're going to punk my kids.
That's slap and snatch senior.
You know it's going to happen. Right?
Yeah, that's slap and snatch senior.
It's not going to happen. Don't wait on that.
You said you wasn't going to do the show. Now you're doing it. Now you said you ain't going to slap
little
nobody.
Girlfriend was in
I
trouble
promise
last
you,
night.
You're going to slap the shit out somebody.
Our son's girlfriend was in trouble last night. Moniece met her for the first time, and Marla and Moniece ganging up. I felt bad for the dude.
What do you mean? Don't get me started on her.
On who, the girlfriend?
Don't get me started on her.
See, ain't no girl going to be enough anyway. No girl is going to walk through this good enough for your son. That's how my mother was. She would just torture.
What?
No girl. Your son's not going to walk in with no girl that you're going to be like, oh.
I could send you through a series of quizzes right now and I could tell.
Well, Marla's not good enough for me. Up in Huntsville.
Show.
Up in Huntsville.
I'm going to call his mother right now.
I do it too.
I've had a few days.
My mom tried to be cute. She's like, Marla. I love you, dear.
Yeah, I like you. Somebody clearly is. David is paying her under the table. Because I knew that I was in trouble when we first got married because she came to me, David, and she said, well, my son never ate sugar cereal until he met you. I said, really? I'm the reason for Cocoa Puffs. Really? You gonna put that on me?
You're going to blame the Fruity Pebbles on me.
Right.
That's what you're going
to. He was eating fresh stomp wheat, but I came along because you were stomping, crushing wheat barefoot. And I came along, and now all of a sudden he's a sugar cereal addict because of me.
Marla and I used to play your mama
That's
jokes
so
at night laying in the bed.
That's so,
so one
funny.
Day she pops up, Mom, you know what Dave said about you? I'm like, oh my God.
You can't bring people in on the mama joke.
Let me tell you how crazy my mother is. I said, You know, Dave was talking about you being on the corner and wearing a fur coat going, hey, pimp, it's so cold. And she said, well, what's wrong? If it was cold, then I would want to have a fur coat.
That's...
I said, Mom, don't go in on your own self.
No, she didn't.
Resist.
It's on now.
Just resist.
It's on now. She's on my side,
too? You have
no idea. Oh, my God.
I was like, you know, your mother was like, she was like Miss Worthington. And I started going back.
Hilarious.
She wore the sash. Dave was like, really? And we would tell jokes, David.
Oh, we start off angry, for real.
We'd be mad. We'd be going off on each other's families. And then we would wake up and tell a joke and literally go until we finally were laughing. It'd be 3 o'clock in the morning. We'd be cracking up.
That's funny.
That's real stuff. That's real talk.
That's why y'all still together.
Anyway, so I want to do some fun stuff with our guest, David.
Okay.
Don't act like that.
Yeah, you know, Mom's calling. You never know.
Well, I don't know what the hell is going to happen.
It's the first time.
My father going to walk in the door in a minute.
With a belt.
Oh, you think you're funny, huh?
With the MP. Military police and
nigga wasn't discharged honorably. He left.
We going to get him now.
We're going to get the whole truth. All right, so we're going to play a game with David Arnold called Funny or Foul.
Okay.
And we're going to show you a picture.
All right.
And you just tell us whether you think that this situation, as you see it in the photo, is funny or foul.
All right.
So Jarvis, if you could pull up the first picture, you pull it up there, and I'm going to go ahead and show him. Is this one? All right. So David, our viewers will see,
can they see it
in a minute. They will. But
yeah,
you're
they're
see
a little time
here.
Delay.
Okay.
Because we got a lot of editing to do when you start, you know, running your mouth. Oh, yeah.
So in case you don't know who this is.
It's Justin Bieber, isn't
yeah,
it?
Yeah, uh-huh.
Okay.
So what do you think? Do you think this
I think it's funny.
You think this is funny?
And let me tell you why. Are we describing what it is?
Well, they can see it.
Oh, they can.
They're funny or foul. That's up to you.
I think it's funny. It's a naked picture of Justin Bieber from behind looking, standing on a boat. This is what I think is funny about that. I think that white people get so much money that they really think they can do any goddamn thing. And his ass is so flat.
And pale.
And pale.
It's not even the same color as the rest of his body.
He disappears in the middle. That's what happens.
That's the first time he ever took his clothes off. He wore the same tiny whities he was born in.
I think that it's funny that money can give you such a false sense of confidence. Because if my ass looked like this, I would never. I don't give a what kind of island you standing
now,
on.
Wait a minute. Hold on. Do you guys really think that
think
guys
ridiculous.
Need to have as much of an ass situation going on as women? Is that an expectation?
To take a picture like that?
Do you need any ass at all? This is now you're the woman.
No ass at all.
Do you need any
I?
Ass at all? Yeah.
Oh, yeah, but I wouldn't say you had a big man kadunkadunk.
I hope not.
No, that don't, we're not gonna. You're not gonna say
you're not
that.
Talking about yeah.
Yeah, but so you think to take your clothes off, you need to be like completely sculpted, or can the man?
Well, definitely
be on
not, because I would never take my clothes off ever. I would if I
you
thought that.
You were a big bear. You look pretty tan. Are you tan all the way?
No, I kept shorts on. That's why I wouldn't take no picture like this.
Okay,
all right, let's move
Jarvis,
on,
Jarvis. Let's pull up the
God
second
damn.
Picture. What do you got? All right. Oh, that's my God. That's the okay.
You just blew the wad. You're not a good comedian. You're not going to stand up. Not, your timing is all off.
Oh, that's not right. Okay, so here's a photo. It's coming up. And we already heard what it is, but I'm going to show you anyway.
You said who it is, but I don't know what it is.
I said it is. I was just, you know. I don't have that one, so we got to wait for it to pop up. The pictures of Donald Trump.
Okay, which?
Donald Trump in himself, funny or foul?
Again, I think he's fucking funny and ridiculous. Because
he's
I think
funny and foul.
He's funny and foul.
At the same
That's
time.
Perfect. At the same damn
you think
time.
So?
Yes.
What? Go ahead.
Because he has so much money that he really thinks he can be the president. And
you know,
he thinks that what the fuck
is,
he's talking about.
I thought it was an outrageous, out-of-control joke.
I thought it was a stunt.
He's leading everybody in the polls.
Oh, no. I know
he is. Even Hillary.
Let me explain something to you.
He's going to be the president.
He's not going to be president.
No, he's not going to be president.
I don't know.
He's not going to be president because he's going to fuck it up eventually, like everybody does. The presidential race is a long race.
I give him full credit. He's tried very hard.
Yeah,
and it's not working. He can't mess up if he wants to.
But a lot of people start off front runners. When these bitches start coming out and talking about him and all the shit he's done, nobody is going
talk about him more than he's already talked about himself. That's the thing. He takes a sting out of it.
Okay.
He just says, yeah.
You going to vote for him?
I gave him $1 million.
Isn't he a Republican too, right?
There's four people in this room, and I can say that no matter how entertaining he may be, he doesn't have my vote. So when
I'm not gonna vote for him.
That's ridiculous.
He's a Republican.
It's like
isn't he?
Voting for a president. He's gonna just play one on TV.
Is he Republican? Yeah.
He's independent.
Okay, but he's Republican. Yeah, of course he's Republican.
He's threatening to go independent if they don't get with him.
Oh, right. Like he's he might make it a close run, but I don't think Donald Trump is gonna be president. And if he becomes the president, whatever the fuck happens to this country, we deserve it.
We should be very afraid.
Yes. Whatever happens to us, we deserve it if that happens.
Definitely.
He's still fucking with Barack Obama and the birth certificate shit. It's over.
It works for him, man.
Yes.
It works for him.
I can't imagine all the people who voted for Barack gonna switch over and vote for Donald Trump. I don't think that's going to happen.
No.
I don't think that he's going to get a portion of that. His hair is horrible. You can't have no goddamn president with his hair looking like that.
You know, the toupee is classic.
It's awful. That little thing looks like if you whistle, it'll jump up off his head and run off.
But you know what's interesting, though? I do kind of find his whole situation kind of interesting because people are tired. And they're getting his attention.
He's got everybody
not talking
anger.
About one single solitary point that has anything to do with policy. So
if it was me, it'd be good.
What you mean?
That's what he's saying. That's his message. If it was me, it'd be better.
Can we bring it back up? So we have another picture up, and this is the picture. This is a naked pregnant Kim Kardashian.
Yeah, this bitch is fantastic.
That's not one of the F's. It's supposed to be funny
or funny or foul.
We're
gonna make a new category for this one. I don't think it's foul at all. I mean, I don't think it's funny. I think it's fantastic. I think ass is as big as her stomach.
She's pregnant everywhere.
Just which everywhere. Is a walking S is what she is.
Now, would you encourage your wife to take a picture like that if she was pregnant
for the public?
Sure.
No. For the this is the thing. When my wife was pregnant, my wife looked like that. Her titties ain't as big, but she looked like that, and it's
you
sexy.
You get a new phone call.
She's sexy, but this is what Kim does. This is why
That's
we like Kim.
And that's why they eat.
Right? Because you know what I'm saying. So I don't think she don't look. Listen, I've seen some people that women pregnant are sexy.
Really?
I think
you're one of those.
I think women who are pregnant are sexy.
I used to be offended when people hit.
They
on
are.
Me
they're
was,
beautiful,
I was
actually.
Pregnant.
Yeah. But that's just different. You know, hey, let me fuck you while you got somebody else's baby in you. That's different. That's a whole different world. But I'm
somebody
saying
on the inside, you just take up the second tier.
That's different. But I'm saying to see a woman, I've seen women out and I go, she's really a beautiful woman.
Are you one of those people who have like a
lactation
fetish?
No. No, that shit got in my wife in my mouth one
time.
It's
nasty, man. It's like, what is this?
I didn't like that. Yeah, I didn't like that at all.
Collard greens? No.
It's too sweet. I didn't like that milk. I don't like that. It got in my mouth one time.
Baby's got it bad.
Right. Surprised the baby don't have diabetes. This shit is too. But I mean, I think that's, you know, I think a woman like that is. But that's what Kim does. Kim is famous.
Well, we got one more. Yeah. One last picture to show you.
Can we see Kim again?
No. We don't go backwards on this show.
I'm on the phone because we got a delay.
Oh,
let's go.
Okay. What's up? Oh, there we go.
This is fantastic.
Here we go. Here's the last one.
What the hell is that? Is that chicken?
Is
that chicken on her ass?
Don't worry about it.
Funny.
I'm
going to have to explain.
Hey, wait a minute. Is it a black dude reaching for chicken?
That's John Legend's wife.
Oh, I can't see.
Tegan, and she says chicken butt is the actual. It says,
that's
what's up, chicken butt?
Hilarious. That's funny.
So now, David, that's actually a tasty
David,
lunch.
David, can you hold that close to the camera?
Okay.
Right there.
There you go. You can see that.
Close. There you go. Right there. So that's what we're talking about right now. Funny or foul?
Chicken on the ass. I think that's funny because you can eat some chicken and then get some ass.
That's a one-stop shop.
I was about to say eat some ass, but that was too much.
Okay,
you're going to get another phone call.
All right. More with David Arnold. We'll be right back.
It's time for the Marla and Dave Doghouse. doghouse.
Marla has something that should put Dave in the doghouse.
Dave has something that should put Marla in the doghouse.
You decide who gets a biscuit
and who gets busted and ends up
in the doghouse.
All right. I had something. I had a hint. We always write our hints down on our doghouse. But
your hint's right there.
No, I don't want my hint anymore. Oh, I changed my doghouse.
You better hurry up because you already lost 10 seconds.
So, David, this is a segment of the show where we get to launch an offense in our marriage against the other person. And everyone probably gets to decide whether you get the biscuit or you get the bone.
And Tony Fontana, be fair.
Tony Fontana's my guy because he is fair. That's why you're usually in the doghouse.
Sandra, please get my bat.
Anyway, here's the deal. I changed it. I am sick and tired. David goes in the doghouse today because either you're going to carry your own man purse or you're going to stop putting all of your shiznit in my purse and then wondering where your stuff is and accusing me of taking it when it's in my purse as you did with the gum on the way over here. Have my gum get in your purse because you put it in my purse.
That's fair.
So you need your own purse. David puts his keys, his wallet. Last night he was mad on the way to dinner because I had a small bag I took with me other than my big purse, and he said, can you just put your sunglasses?
I said, no. Hey, can you put my sunglasses in the car? She's putting her sunglasses in the purse.
It's my purse. All the compartments were taken because it's my purse.
Well, you're my wife. I could have shoved them somewhere else, but that wouldn't be cool, right?
Okay.
That might have just got me in the doghouse right
there. Right, you see, anyways,
watch this. So Marla is always getting on me for driving and texting at the same time. She's all nervous.
Right.
I get in the car with Marla. She's in her little BMW with her knees doing the steering, on the phone with this hand, doing makeup with the other. I'm not even sure if she's ever even looking at the road.
What are you talking about?
We are in grave danger driving down the freeway with Marla, and she's swerving everything. To her credit, she can get it back. I don't know how she drives with her knees like that, but I don't even know how she gets the car to go.
Who is this wife you speak of? Because it is not me.
Are you kidding? this really pushed you in the doghouse. Are you going to say you don't drive with your knees?
I may drive with my knees, but only to eat.
And drink your water and do anything else?
Only to eat, not to be texting.
Are you
going to
say that you did not ever put on makeup while driving with your knees?
Yeah, you can't say
that. I do not know this man.
That's not the question. Did you drive with your knees?
Maybe.
And put on makeup?
Sometimes I got to multitask.
Okay, and so that makes her a hypocrite.
And that makes you a man with your own BMW. Get in your own damn car and get out of mine. There you go.
Wow, and she's rude. Did I not just win? Did I not just win? Tony Fontana, you got to get my back on that. We'll be right back.
What's the action?
You'll laugh. You'll learn. You'll learn. Mm-hmm. You'll get mad.
Shut up.
You'll get happy. But you won't be bored.
This is the Marla and Dave Radio Show on the Universal Broadcast Network.
All right, so I know we'll get those votes in a minute. I know I had to win that one.
Yeah, Guess what? Your apple has been, somebody took a bite out of your apple, and I'm the only one with the computer. So chances are, you're definitely going in the doghouse.
Oh, see, now you got to really lose. Now she's not even honest? What?
Put that on the list.
Tony Fontana, dude, I thought we were like this.
Nice,
you're
Tony.
You're hurting me.
Nice, Tony.
Tony says, rough, Marlo. What?
Nice.
T. Woo! Fontana, what?
This is the first time you ever won?
You are the guardian.
No, for Tony to vote for me. Yeah, he's a Marla fan.
Ah.
Says bark, bark, Marla. Deny, deny, deny.
Hilarious.
That is hilarious. Okay, hold on. We got another one. Nicole Harris says both of you should get in the doghouse. I do not want to be locked up in a doghouse with him.
Don't you understand? As long as you bring the chicken and put on that nice little Chrissy Teigen outfit, you know, we might have a good time in the doghouse.
This is why. The doghouse is purgatory for me. At one point, David, I was taking a pole dancing class, and one of my friends
don't blow past that like it's regular shit. Dude, I was taking a pole dancing class with my ass out. You know, I was talking. No, hold up. You gonna blow past the pole dancer like it's regular?
What?
Oh my god! Wait.
All right, so you were stripping, and what happened?
Right.
Yeah, we're getting ready for the doghouse.
I was taking a pole dancing class, and one of my friends suggested that we put a pole in our kitchen or in some place.
In the house.
two or three places. I said, okay.
It just poles everywhere, like a firehouse on steroids.
So I said, clearly we will not be friends. Because if you put a pole, that's like a servitude. Like, I'd be stuck on a pole. David would have me pole dancing. He tried to sneak. He was... When's the class? I said,
that's
dude, you
funny.
Can't come.
I can bring dollars. I can bring dollar bills.
Don't even ask.
It's going to be a fun class.
Don't ask.
But wait a minute. Wait a minute. Why are you taking the pole dancing class if he can't
I'm
see it?
I'm about to go back.
Back where? To the stripper pole?
Yes, I'm
going back to your roots? You know, when David met me, he had several singles in his pocket. And I said, hey, don't you sing with Take Six? He was like, well, let a nigga get you off the pole for a I got this song that's going to take us to the top. You ain't got to strip like this no more. Me and Mark and some other people. Me and Claude.
Just
we
some
all
random
go.
Dudes.
Some other people.
Some other people. We're going to give everybody credit in the group. It really should be Take
man.
Two. The mother
skipper two.
Niggas is
and
in the way.
The rest here on Gilligan's Isle. Like, I don't even get a name.
How you not going to want him to see? How you gonna not want him to see you? That's why you take it, right?
No, listen. I'm about to. Here's what I like to do. Let me just explain.
They think it's exercise.
In case
you know,
everybody knows that I'm a fitness trainer, but I like to start one new thing and try to champion it. Now, I kind of my pole dancing situation was interrupted,
right?
But I did a whole season of outrigger canoeing. I raced. I went up and down the coast, and I joined an outrigger canoe club.
Okay.
So I pick something I haven't
very
done and I try to commandeer.
White of you.
Yeah, I know. That's how it's my brain.
We
it
had
was money.
The pole
it
teacher as a guest on the show. She tried to get me to come to the pole stripping
and
class.
And you and Claude McKnight, don't get it twisted, said you were going to
and
come.
I was going
to man pole.
I was glad to come until she told me I had to wear my own spandex shorts. I was like, oh
hell no.
No, man.
They're going. They're gonna take man pole.
Let me explain something.
That
you.
Just doesn't sound
just
because right.
You put yeah, the you word man in front
Jarvis
of something.
Jarvis had said one word on it. He's like, oh no, no,
he said,
no,
hell no. He about to shut the computers off. He done had enough. Just because you put the word man in front of it, don't make it acceptable.
Dave, you're not down? You know, come take
No, I'm not going to be a part of any
but
of it.
But the way you, the semantics,
I'm not
going to
I'll
take
watch.
The man
you're not,
pole.
You don't take the pole, Dave?
No, I don't want to take
Dave,
nothing and pole don't
pole?
Go together.
Yeah, you don't say it like that.
You guys said you would take the pole.
You just ruined it for every guy going to the class.
Every man just
I'm
went,
I'm
going to
keep my dollar bills at home.
This is horrible.
It's whatever. See how they don't want
to. I want to go to the pole. I go to Atlanta. Atlanta is the best pole. It's
magic,
the strippers.
You want to go to the magic?
Magic or the what's the other one?
We don't know.
I'm about to
David,
tell you.
David, don't say
just
it.
Give me a minute. David, no. Magic.
what's the other thing?
It's not fair when you leave your wife at
Onyx.
Home.
Onyx.
I've never heard of that.
Oh, it's fantastic.
I was just talking
magic
to Darren
like
today.
The
magic.
Old.
No, magic is still happening, but Onyx, I like Onyx better.
Let's talk about the attraction. I love the strippers.
I
the general
these,
statement.
I love these.
I love
these
the
bitches
strippers.
Are fantastic.
What happens?
They're like, really good.
So like, what are you? Are you like? Do you like take a? Do
no,
you
Marla,
score it?
You have to admit.
Hold on.
We went to that
hold
one
on.
Place one time.
Hold
yeah,
on,
Marla
but,
went to the stripper.
But
that's
look.
What's sexy about it.
But what?
That's
no,
it.
No, no,
that's
but
the attraction.
But do you score it? Because what you said, he tried to act like it was. These bitches are fantastic. What's
they
what,
are.
What are you judging by?
Do
are you judging by the clap?
The okay, first of all, the ass clap is great. But okay. If you see a woman climb to the ceiling on a pole
yeah, 17 stories high
with her legs and pop up and do the shit they do, that
yeah,
is
that's seems
just
dangerous.
Pretty good. But it ain't they don't seem to be in pain. It, and that's what's incredible.
See, for me, by the end of the
until
night, it went from sexy to like,
those,
yeah, oh yeah, they be doing it all.
We actually saw what you're saying. We saw we went to a party, and there was a there was at a strip club,
right?
And this chick was at the top of the pole, which
right.
is to the roof,
right?
But she
but let me describe this though before she drops. She's holding the pole with all different angles of her body. You
right.
know, they put the earlobe around
right,
it.
Right.
Hang on it with
just
the
on
earlobe.
Her mouth. Just
like,
hanging it. Right.
Look at this. But she flips around to where she's just clapping her booty around the pole.
Oh, wow.
And she's faced out.
Like a
and
flower.
Her ass is holding.
And then she does
okay.
another
ass,
move.
All thighs and ass.
She does another move, and she's like that.
She
upside
falls.
Down.
And she yeah. free falls.
And she just,
But she didn't hit the ground. Because
she stopped. Right before, that's what I'm talking about.
With the
about.
Cheeks. The cheeks just grabbed the pole like an elevator.
If she can grab a pole with her ass like that,
you
imagine.
Be, that,
wait,
do
no,
you
that's
know
not
many,
sexy, man.
Shh.
she
She's
is.
Gonna break you,
you
off.
Think you wanna mess
for real? No, not in a nice way.
Now you gotta go home and explain where your dick at. Where your dick at? You know I was driving.
And I just happened to be by Magic City. I don't know what happened.
You know, a funny thing happened on the way home. I brought you some ice cream.
Nicole said, when stripping becomes art form, and Tony Fontana said, that's athletic.
It is. Oh, it's fast. Let me tell you something. People who have not been to Atlanta and seen these strippers, because I like when I first.
So wait, LA doesn't have.
No, not even close.
No, we saw this in L.A.
Not even. Oh,
what we're describing, we saw in L.A.
I've never seen nothing like this.
It was a club called Peanuts. I don't even think they're still around.
Yeah, see, they gone. I never even. Atlanta. I was in Atlanta when
they
I was
They did
writing.
Move to Atlanta.
When I was there, I was writing Tyler Perry's House of Pain. And I went there to work, and that's where I always heard about the strip
House
clubs.
House of Pain, huh?
I wrote House of Pain and Meet the Browns.
Okay.
Yeah.
And you got in Atlanta, and you got stuck in the. In Onyx.
And I went there to write church
you went to
stuff
Onyx.
For Tyler Perry. And then I went to the strip club.
Just to get it back.
You're doing research.
Just to get it back.
Working for that nigga made me want to go to the strip club. And it was the most, the sexy thing for me is, honestly, is seeing the women. It's just as many women in the club as it is men.
So will your wife go with you?
I want her to. When she came to Atlanta one time, I almost got her to go. She didn't go. But
you
I'm
already
get
said
her
she
go.
Was on the wrong van. She's not. Yeah, she
I want her to go because I think it's
David
sexy.
David has some edibles stored somewhere. He's going to get his wife to eat
I'm going to get her
before
she know. I'm going to get her before she for it. I don't even
I'm going to follow around
when
for
they
that
make
reality
pizza. She's going to be strict. Just like, oh, just a nice little pizza.
And I don't even get high. That's why.
I don't feel good, honey.
It's like taking off your clothes.
This was you. That's hilarious. So, okay, so you got into the whole art form of it all. So
yeah,
it was impressive.
I was impressed by it. I was impressed by the whole, everybody
did you
in
donate?
The club.
Did you donate any money?
Yeah, of course.
Really?
Thousands. You know what I want to do? I will
Here's
be honest
what's
with you.
Whack about a comedian. You never know. I'm looking at his face and I'm like,
he's dead serious. He stopped joking. He was like, no, thousands.
One day, I was like, I had to do it one time. Wanted to, you know, you throw the money up and make it rain.
Yeah.
I had to do it one time.
How'd that work out? How'd that feel?
You know,
does it pay off when you make it rain?
You know, you do it and it's like, bitch is picking up your money. You're like,
you see Dave kind of jumping, gyrating on stage. Yeah. Yeah, girls, let me just, excuse me.
Excuse me, that's
nothing
my
to see here. I did take a man pole class one time.
Try to make this thousand I threw up in the air back. I did it one time. I was like, that didn't feel as good as I thought it was going
to
feel.
Oh, my God. To my mad family in the chat room, these two are absolutely killing me today. I don't even know. It's too much. You did two or three things. You bringing out a conversation with men in the room.
I'm trying to get it back from what he started the show with. Dave don't have it. Dave can't
be
funny.
I didn't say that.
I'm trying to get it back.
No, Dave, actually, you know what? You are funny because you got that. You got that.
Thank you.
You quick. She's funny too. You're both funny. You couldn't do this if you wasn't funny. You got that quick, that boom thing. Now you have
I
a filter. Huh?
Well, my filter has been beat into me. Because right.
Yeah, Marla, you probably got less of a filter than
Dave. Yeah, that's
got.
True. That's true.
But here's the thing.
But I've been taught to be nice.
But that's the part that's where you stand as a comedian. When you remove that filter, it's over.
Yeah.
Because now you do stand up.
So is my marriage.
Up.
My marriage.
Well,
is over
no, not necessarily.
Because I did stand up. Remember, Dave, for
yes,
a little bit, and he would run
no,
away.
It was because you were rude. Again, you were rude.
He would come and sit there. And
she'd be at home working on all kind
him.
Of materials: spaghetti, macaroni and cheese. Oh, here comes Dave with his receding hairline. When Dave watches a movie, you don't even got to look at the screen. I'm like, oh,
that's hilarious.
God.
Let me tell you something. That's some good material that stay with you years later.
You
I'm going to tell you
what,
that
Dave?
Right
now. And I walk in a room, I'm like, oh, my God. She's still
there's
up there.
She own one.
There's another first. The first time I've ever walked away from my own mic in my
that's
show.
That's like, funny.
Because
man,
it's
I
true.
Can't catch a break.
There's so much
don't
truth.
You have anything else to talk about?
You know what's so funny? Everybody always asks me too, like, because I do a lot. If you've seen me work, I do a lot of material on my wife and family.
And you have, by the way, I have seen you recently, and I promote it here.
Okay.
The he said, she said,
right.
Because it was just freaking funny. Bottom line, it's a great show. Again,
we're doing 30 cities all over the country.
Incredible! Yeah, I told people to find you. We got to make sure they.
Yeah, if you go, you can see me and Kim Whitley at KYMWHITLAY, and I'm at David A. Arnold. David A. Arnold, and we're touring. Next stop is in Baltimore. We're doing the Baltimore Comedy Factory. We just sold out 6 shows in Cleveland. We've just been killing. And me and Kim are, you know, it's one of those shows where you never see 2 comedians on stage at the same time.
They're hilarious.
Kim goes up, then I go up, then we go up together.
Okay.
And we just
I really don't want to do a spoiler, but I know why you do the show. You just want to get to the end.
To the end of the show?
Uh-huh.
What do you mean?
When the two of you are holding each other's genitalia. I don't understand. I think that's a free pass for you. I think you just came up with.
Oh, you came up with that, duh.
Right.
I came up with it. But you know what it is? It's so funny because we were like, we need a disclosure joke. No, but that's the thing. Me and Kim are such brother and sister.
Oh, right. Right.
That we don't have that.
Yeah, but we don't have
that. We have the family tree
thing.
So
you went back down south because it's not even a sexual thing. It's a brother and sister sexual thing.
There's no sexual tension between. That's why we can work together like we do. And I think, honestly, that's why we're as funny as we are.
Wait, that brings up another question.
That because I had to laugh because the show I saw, it was actually David's anniversary and his wife was sitting at the table. So of course he said, yeah, we're brother and sister. I'm like, yeah, he just got a free feel.
Yeah, until you get to Cleveland.
That's right.
Until you in South Dakota, then girl, that's too cold up in here.
Put one of them titties open. You know, Kim Whitley got them titties. You could disappear under them titties. Kim Whitley got.
She probably got a sandwich under there too. You never know. You can eat and be warm. Everything.
Tony Fontana is trying to encourage your comedy career.
Thank you, Tony.
Tony says you could talk about me and have people peeing in their pants.
There it is. That's probably.
There's not that much funny
Listen,
stuff
if
you, can
you
say
want
about
to take
me,
the class, Dave, you
I
can
think
come
I
and
might.
Take the class.
I probably
and
should.
I will set you.
And I will kill you.
It was. You can't
there can
see?
Only be one funny person in this family.
6. We do 6 weeks. We're going to do another class at the end of September. And we do it at the Ha Ha Cafe in North Hollywood. And if you wanted to take the class, I definitely would bring you in and let
now,
you do
look,
it.
Now, here's the key. Here's
he
the thing.
Now, Grammys.
If
is
I
that
leave,
not enough?
If
can I be
I miss,
the
will the
family?
Military police show up if I skip a day? I might be in Cleveland myself.
You're going to jail.
That's hilarious. No, it's, you know what? Let me tell you something. I do the class because I love doing it, and nobody helped me when I came here. Like, I had no idea what I was doing. I didn't know anybody. I just knew where I came here knowing I wanted to be a comedian and with the addresses of the comedy clubs. That's it. I didn't know what night was what.
Wow.
Who was in charge? With,
they got vicious when I used to do open mic night. They were ridiculous with it. Sometimes
cats
they were
be
so
fighting
stupid
in the line.
Yeah,
it's 3 o'clock.
Well, I never had to do that. I got lucky.
I did that.
I never had to do open mic here because when I met Pauly Shore in Atlanta, I was performing. I opened up for him in Atlanta, and he was like, you know, you should come and perform at my mom's club, who owns the
comedy store, right?
And I was like, I'm actually moving to LA in like 2 months. He said, well, here's my number. When you get here, call me. I'll get you a showcase. And I called him, and he actually got me a showcase.
Wow.
And I showcased for Mitzi, and I showcased one time, and I got in.
Wow.
And that was the first. And that was the first time. And
that's when you know it's meant to be, though.
And I got in, and now my name is written. You know, you go to comedy store, and all the names are on the wall. Yeah. And I remember when they put my name on the wall, and I had no idea because
what
I
that
was
meant.
None.
You're right.
None. Yeah. It happened so quick. Because I showcased one time and got in. I didn't get it.
Because it was meant to be, right?
Until I look back 10 years later and I see how many people showcased over and over and over.
Yeah.
And I just went from that to the other comedy club and then I realized that there was 2 different worlds of comedy.
Right.
There's black comedy and white comedy.
Right.
I didn't know that here.
Wait, we got to get to that. But right before we do, though, sometimes, and I hope this doesn't sound chauvinistic,
right?
But sometimes women just aren't as funny as dudes. What is with that?
I have to agree.
Everybody says that.
It's almost like they try too hard sometimes.
Listen, Wanda Sykes is funny.
She's funny.
Kim is funny.
Kim Whitley is funny.
Yeah.
There are.
But they seem to have a guy's timing.
I don't know what a guy's timing means. I don't know what that. I think that when you have a real voice as a comedian and you there's a documentary you should watch, and it's called Why We're Funny, I think is the name of it. And it's all about female comedians.
Really?
Mm. Yeah. Mm-hmm. And it goes from everybody talks about their experience as a female in the male driven thing. And it's not easy, But if you got more to talk about than just men ain't shit and men with little dicks, then you can have a career. And I always try to push
maybe that's what it
female
is.
Comedians it away from be, that topic.
And I think yeah. it also has to be something that's relatable, which is what we talked about earlier.
Right.
Like, you can't step outside your zone.
Right.
I was good doing jokes at the Comedy Store being in Hollywood. When I went over to the black neighborhood, I was a complete failure.
Well, as you can tell, we're
that's
having a good time.
Yep, yep. And that's a different. We'll talk about it.
We're going to be back with more with David Arnold.
It's time to play the Marla and Dave love game. Here are Marla and Dave to explain how it works.
All right, as you know, those of you who follow the show know that the MaD Love Game was a game created by Marla and me. It has the three categories that we think affect most relationships. That's finance, sex, and communication. It's played by rolling a single die that has those categories on it, as well as the MaD logo. When it lands on the MaD logo, you get to choose.
It's wild.
And you usually choose sex. Because, quite frankly, it's the most fun. Anyway, we're going
to
pass it to our guest. Boom. Let him roll the die.
Street style.
Oh, and he...
lose a turn. Oh, lose a turn the first time. What the hell is
lose
this?
Lose a turn. Oh, no. Marla's about to roll.
Bring it home to mama.
I might have to communicate.
Money.
Money.
Oh, my God. All right, so money. Here we go. Let's get a question. Oh, here's a good one. How much money should a man expect to spend on a wedding ring?
Woo.
How much money should a man expect? Dave, what do you think?
That depends on how much you want to lose if you don't work out and she walks away. just enough that you don't want to kill this bitch if it don't work out.
Who asked you about the risk factor?
No, that's the first thing I think of. If she walk away with this ring, I need to spend just enough that I won't kill this
that
bitch.
That sounds like an episode of Ballers.
You got me for $2,000.
All right, so for those of you who don't know, these answers usually come from the PEW Research Center, the Pew Research Center.
Oh, I know the real answer.
Oh, go ahead.
Oh, it's a real answer.
Yeah.
Oh, the answer is, I forgot what percentage of it is of his income. It's supposed to be one-third of
one
his income.
One and a half years of his salary, I believe.
Yeah, see, spoken like a true woman.
Yeah, I'm about to say.
The origin of the real answer is the origin of the 2 months salary. They usually say it should be 2 months salary.
Years.
Okay.
I think whatever you make for 1.5 years, I should have that rock on my finger.
What?
It's a trick. It was put out there by the De Beers family.
Oh, hell
They're
no.
the largest diamond producer
right.
and marketer in the world.
I'm
and they
a rock
said, hey.
It should be this big right
and
now.
They said,
so
hey. You know, it should be about 2 months salary. Accordingly, the price of diamonds was set at approximately 2 months of salary, which is somewhat tied to inflation. A groom is likely to spend at least $2,500.
I do know this, that a wedding ring, an engagement ring should be the second most expensive purchase that a man makes in his life. It's supposed to be your house, the ring,
what?
The car. I promise you, I looked that up.
See,
should
a woman
wrote that. And so the fun thing about this game is when you're playing with your friends or a group of people, it has a question for further discussion, really, really gets crazy. This further discussion question for this card says, should a woman have a say in picking her own ring?
Hell yeah.
Oh, yeah. I think so.
Think so?
I mean,
well, you can wait.
You
don't want to
spend a whole bunch of money.
And then she'd be like, I didn't want that shit.
She'd be like,
you did that.
Don't, bitch.
Try it again. You did want a yes, right?
Right.
Did you want me to say yes? All right, let's try it. Roll one more. Let's play one more card.
Sex?
It's sex.
All right, sex. Let's go. Let's see here. Let's get a sex question here.
Something tells me that the dice is loaded.
What's the last two numbers of the?
Can too much masturbation be physically harmful?
Can what?
Too much masturbation be physically harmful?
Well, can I see your hand?
I mean, I was in the hospital one time.
I think it's true.
I blamed it on
David. David's got calluses. I don't know.
Somebody put
check
hot
it
sauce
out.
In my Vaseline.
I'm blaming it on something else, but.
And so, what do you think?
Can
yes
too
or no?
much be
masturbation
physical?
Be physically harmful?
For a woman, I think. For a man, I don't think
what?
So.
What? What are you okay. a? What yeah. are you a masturbation chauvinist?
No, I'm just saying, man. I mean, after you.
So what?
After two times, you ain't. Come on, you just can't keep going. A woman can keep just rubbing herself out if she wants to. A man can't.
You made it sound like a maneuver. A
that's what it is. You're rubbing yourself out.
She can rub herself out.
You can rub it out. A man can't do that. After a while, your penis is going to be like, listen, this is where I get off.
I mean, you can keep doing, you keep doing it if you want
to.
It's going to be without me.
I ain't got nothing else for you.
That stupid. Yes, I say that, I say that physically harmful, no. I think there's always too much of a good thing.
All right. The simple answer, of course, is no. But for further discussion, does it encourage discourage sexual relations with your partner when you're just jacking it all day long?
I think it discourages.
It's probably, it probably discourages
because
it.
Because there's a reason why if you have a partner, you're going to yourself and not your partner.
Sometimes you just want to get in and get out. You don't want to have a whole lot of conversation. So that's
it's like you don't have to smoke the cigarette, you gotta do all that. It's just over.
I ain't gotta rub your back and do all this shit and act like I care about your day. Sometimes I just wanna knock this out and watch TV.
Again, that's the Mad Love Game. We thank our guests for playing. You can get your own version of the Mad Love Game at www.marlandave.com in the store. Back to the show.
Never do anything without thinking about it first.
Marla is a feeler.
I basically wear my personality on my sleeve.
But when Marla and Dave get together,
it's like a match dancing with a firecracker.
This is the Marla and Dave Radio Show on the Universal Broadcast Network.
So I'm pronouncing this young lady's name correct, David. I'm saying Yvette, but you're saying Yvette. Yvette Foy?
Yes, Yvette. Mm-hmm.
Okay, so Yvette is chatting it up in the chat room. And
she's a very funny stand-up comedian.
Yeah, she's
writer.
Talking about doctor's orders. It's very funny.
She's very funny. She took my class.
She said the doctor said...
Oh, that's what made her funny. Yeah, notice how he got funny. She's a very funny stand-up comedian brilliant. And writer.
She said the doctor said, class, give it a rest, son.
It's at the
doctor
cafe.
Said, give it a rest.
Give it a rest, son.
It's at the High Cafe if you ever want to sign up. We got 239 people on our waiting list.
Crazy, man.
Oh, but you're going
to
get David.
I'm going to have to come for sure.
David wanted to come out
for sure. Even if I can't take the whole class,
you should come and check
I'm going to sit in.
You should come and check it out. We're in development for a reality show. I mean, literally just signed my contract last week with Pilgrim Studios. They do Kim Whitley's own. Raising Whitley. Yeah. I just signed a deal with them too. We're creating a television show based on the class.
Awesome.
So it's really.
I bet that's funny, man. When you have people who just aren't funny.
Yes.
That's the time when I watched those American
that's
Idol.
That's all I
people
did.
Can't
I
sing.
Never
that's
saw
what I
one
watched.
Episode of American Idol. I only watched the auditions. That's the truth.
It's the journey. But that's the journey. It's the journey. That's what the class and that's what the show is actually about. It's about the journey of trying to do this because it's not always funny.
All right, there you go. It's time for this week's poll question. Is being a submissive woman a trait of the past? That's been up all week. Is being a submissive woman a trait of the past? Your options were yes, hashtag independent women, or no, hashtag a woman's nature. Oh, we can only wish. Anyway, it must have been a lot of women on this answering this poll question because they
I'm
said
a tyrant because he's begging for the doormat.
It was 100% yes, independent women.
Dave, are you?
See, that's the problem.
You really make
it. You know?
That's the problem.
This
right
is what's
there.
Sad. If we don't make it, you just are out there like
y'all
a sad puppy.
Where y'all? They've been married 52 years. Where the hell are these two going? Wherever, y'all gonna leave each other, go with some other people, and end up back at the same house. She put you out too, huh?
Yeah.
Told me she ain't want to fuck with me no more.
She didn't make my kind of chicken. That wasn't my. You know, I like that ass chicken.
I like that ass chicken. Ass chicken is hilarious.
But two, you done? Are the Davids done?
All right, so the poll question for this week coming up is, at what age should a parent expect a child? Should a parent expect a child? Marla, you must have wrote this.
A grown child. I did write that.
Okay, so why don't you fix this up for me? Because I can't read this.
At what age should a parent expect a grown child, when your children grow up, to make an equal emotional investment in your relationship?
Your options are 18 plus, 21 or older, or 30 or older?
You mean as equally as what you do as a parent?
No, like yes. Emotionally, you're on equal par. Like
don't happen to you. They're almost dead.
Well, you at one point you get kids or you start to realize, man, this is what my parents.
Oh, we're talking about.
Yeah. So like you, okay. The relationship shifts.
We shouldn't
shifts.
Talk about this because they're going to pull in, right?
No, we can talk about it.
Oh, yeah, okay, we can talk about it in a minute, though, because we're about to get right back to the rest of the show.
Dave keeps us on.
Can you handle the truth? This is modern American dialogue in a mad world from two unique, fresh, transparent perspectives. This is the Marla and Dave Radio Show.
Let's get those mics back. Hey, Jarvis, what's up, man? I think we had a caller on the line.
Did we?
Did I just talk right through that?
If you call us back right now. Do it right now. We're waiting. Call us right back. Anyway, David Arnold and I were laughing because David, in case you guys didn't know.
Oh, yeah, you call it. She just called.
We're the clock. David is the clock Gestapo. He will crush you over a clock. And David Arnold just got a little taste of David.
Yeah,
Thomas's.
I had to shut it down. I'm sorry, man.
But I get it. I have my own radio show. I did one last year.
You got to stay on it.
I say that you should be able to have some abstract time. I don't think that the clock is going to, you know, change one way or another. I'm just saying. We should be able to talk over it.
Hilarious, man.
Yeah, but see, you know, Jarvis doesn't laugh that much, so Jarvis is serious. He might get mad. He's looking at that clock like he was giving me signs like... The signs went from this, and the son's finger started going. I'm like, right. Oh, Jarvis.
Jarvis was throwing gang signs?
I didn't know what to do. Reminded me of the 80s.
Straight out of UBN.
I had to look to see what color I was wearing.
Okay, we got a caller on the line. Let's take this call before we get out of here. Hi, you're on the Marla and Dave Show with Marla, Dave, and David Arnold. Who's calling?
This is Kim Whitley, David Arnold.
Oh, Kim Whitley, the sidekick.
Kim, I really didn't say that about your breast. That was David A.
You heard what he said, Kim?
See what I'm saying? Because I couldn't get my little radio thing to get
out. He said you had a sandwich under your left titty. That's what David said.
No, I used to have a sandwich. I ate that one.
Oh, okay, yeah. I was looking for it.
I was looking for that earlier when my blood sugar dropped.
That is, well, Kim, we were hailing you as one of the women that in comedy that we recognize to be extremely
funny.
Hilariously funny.
Yeah.
And so.
Oh, well, thank you. I appreciate that. I'm trying to keep it going.
My husband tends to think that you might be. What were you saying? What
women.
Negative stuff were you saying about women in comedy? You
want
to say it to Kim?
No, Kim, I want you to speak on this. We recognize you as a very funny comedian. Why aren't there more women who are as funny as you?
Hey,
they're not her.
I think there are.
No, Kim. Now be honest.
Put the food down. How you gonna call on the radio with food in you? You know what? God damn it!
Just let me swallow. Let me get
sweet. You sure you eating, Kim?
Are you swallowing food?
That was loaded right there. Let me swallow.
No, I don't. Less well. Okay, so let me explain something to you. I think there are a lot of funny women in comedy. I just don't believe they have the opportunity to shine or be seen.
So, in other words, it is a man's world, and women got to work twice as hard to get there.
Absolutely, and it's still the case. I believe that not only that, there's two things that happen with women in comedy. One, just trying to get through the thickness of it and all the men trying to get on stage for some stage time to shine. That's number one. Number two is women, we have families. If we have children or men and we're always trying to find a man, it takes up all our time. Men don't do that.
We don't. We pick one bitch and stick with her.
No, I didn't say all that. But pretty much, y'all, men don't, they don't have to have the babies. They ain't got to feed everybody. They ain't got to do all that extra stuff. I think a lot of women get wrapped up. If they have children, it's hard to get out to the club.
Their attention is divided.
That is true.
Oh, my God. After you have fed that child, done their homework, you are exhausted.
Which Kim has done none of that.
Fight at the club? That's a fight for a spot. A lot of women give up. It's hard.
That's true. Well, we have a divided role. So the bottom line is putting your time in and getting it out there. A lot of women support. Yeah.
It is true. It's very hard. I get that from the women and comedians I work with all the time. They all say, I got a family and I got this and that. And it just becomes a thing of which one you want to put time in.
Well, you can't, but we don't really get, with like Kim is saying,
so
we don't really get the
women,
option.
Yeah, Dave, just diss your family?
No, some people don't have, some of these women don't have. Like they don't have children. Some of them don't. They choose to not have children to have
and
a career.
And that's why too.
If that's what you, but not if that's what you want.
Right.
If that's
until
what you want.
Until you realize it's too late.
You think that's what you want.
Right.
Right.
Because you give your. I remember a man told me when I'll never forget it. Junie Smith was my first teacher, and I remember we went into his little class. You know, we were in the class, the workshop, and I never understood because they was one of them soul brothers, like they was with the nation or something. But they was like, don't give your womb to this business. Wow. When they said womb, but I never understood what they meant.
That's true. That's very true.
And that was the first lesson in Hollywood. And they knew that because they were older and they had seen their colleagues.
Give it up.
Their career, and then all of a sudden they fight for the career. For the, now the eggs done got old.
Right.
The eggs done got old? Is that what happened? The eggs got old?
Is that going to make a bad kid, or what's going to happen when you get an old
little
egg?
Dumbass
when
kid.
When an old egg hatches.
You have a... You have a 16-year-old.
You know what, Kim? We appreciate you calling in, and we want to actually have you on our show. And then
yeah,
we
Kim,
see
you
got to
come in here and sit with these two.
You, then you see how tough Dave talks then when you're in the room.
Marla was at our show at the Ha Ha.
To be there. Okay.
We'll make it happen.
K-Y-M Whitley, W-H-I-T-L-E-Y. David, holler at me later on when you finish with your wife.
Well, right. Well, right quick before you go, Dave told us that you guys are about to be on the road. Let's pump that up a little bit.
Yes, we're about to do Baltimore. That's our next stop.
Yeah, we've been killing.
Baltimore
Comedy Factory. The Baltimore Comedy Factory, September 24th through the 26th.
Nice.
That's it.
So to our MaD family out in Baltimore, get the word out. He Said, She Said is an awesome show. I've been there. I've seen it. I would see it again. And I paid to see the show. So don't think
that's
I got
awesome.
The celebrity
hookup. That's the real love. That's the real love. Kim,
and
thanks for
calling in. And
then
they made me buy drinks. What's up with that?
Thanks for calling in, Dave. Thanks for coming on the show,
I appreciate
show,
y'all.
It's
a great show. I had a great
day.
Time. Thank you, brother.
Awesome.
Good luck to y'all, man. Thank you.
So we have MaD only Monday. Next week, we'll be talking in depth about our MaD dilemma.
I'll be the singer. You tell me. Oh. I'm going to invite you to my clinic.
As soon as I started singing, I knew he was going to say something
and
smart.
And on that note,
God damn it.
That's been David Arnold. We're Marla and Dave, and we are navigating MaD relationships from
inside
of
our relationship. See you next week.